the entire time? This is going live, you guys.
It's going live?
Yeah. On Facebook. I need someone to fill in the food. Come up to the table.
I'm going to share with that.
The speaker
is to charge. It's a portable basket.
People signing up, so.
Please come and take a seat. We're about to start. War History, Understanding the Army of the Republic of Vietnam. So briefly, the new Vietnam Studies Initiative at UC Davis promotes the study of contemporary Vietnam with organized talks and symposiums relating to Vietnam and its diaspora for over a few years now. And themes like the legacy of Agent Orange and speakers such as internationally renowned artists, activists, scholars, scientists, filmmakers, government officials, and so on, have participated in these seminars. We'll be hosting a symposium on humanitarian work in Vietnam during the winter 2017, and one on business in Vietnam, spring 2017. So keep an eye out for those. If you're interested in contemporary Vietnam issues, please, if you're interested in contemporary Vietnam issues, please see me afterwards or email us at newvietnamstudies@gmail.com. newvietnamstudies@gmail.com. We'll have information up here. We also are working on a website which will have more of this information at newvietnam.ucdavis.edu, and much more to come ahead. We'll be gathering a consortium of scholars, students, community members, those in the private industry, politicians, etc., as part of the new Vietnam Studies Initiative for meetings in the winter and in the spring. So if you're interested in being part of this, again, contact us. There will also be an international conference and contemporary Vietnam issues here in UC Davis in the fall of 2017, so a larger event. And honestly, this is an exciting time to work on new areas in a rapidly developing Vietnam and the challenges it faces, including those in the diaspora. Aside from New Vietnam Studies Initiative, we also want to thank you, the Vietnamese American community of Sacramento, Bacos, for hosting earlier an event with meet and greet panelists and some of the community members are here today, tonight also, so that's just wonderful to see. This event was sponsored by organizations and departments on campus, and they include, I want to thank Department of Asian American Studies, the East Asian Studies Program, the American Studies Program, Circle K International, UC Davis, the International Relations Program, the Culture Studies Program, the Department of Religious Studies, Hmong Student Union, the Institute of Social Sciences, Vietnamese Cancer Awareness Research and Education Society, or VN Cares, the Vietnamese American Community of Sacramento, VACOS, the Division of Student Affairs, the Department of History, and the Humanities Program at UC Davis. So this huge list tells me two things. One, there's an interest in the Army Republic of Vietnam, or ARVN, issues, and generally Vietnam-related topics on campus. And number two, it tells that my team of hardworking and highly resourceful research students are really great at putting together an event. And they include, and I want to thank Leslie Doe, Philip Nguyen, Pinyin Van, Vinh Nguyen, Ji Dong, and Mingy Cruz. So, you know, really, this could not have happened without the sponsors and the students involved. The symposium Revisiting Vietnam History, Understand the Army Republic of Vietnam brings together a panel of international, multiracial, multigenerational, and interdisciplinary writers of ARVN. Their bios on the sheet that you got coming in, and so, you know, you have that, and they will be speaking more about their work shortly. So I believe with my introduction to addressing the big question here, why this ARVN panel, and why now? Simply put, there's been an upsurge of writings on ARVN, in part because so many of those that have first had experience in the Vietnam War era have passed or experiencing health issues. The clock is running out on them to get their stories out and for us to document their histories. Also, after decades of limited and biased writing on ARVN, there's immense interest in giving alternative and even more complete perspectives. So, can you put in the image? How many of you guys have seen this image before?
Everybody.
Yeah, everybody, exactly. I think this image, you know, best depicts, you know, this is a Eddie Adams Pulitzer Prize-winning photograph of Nguyễn Ngọc Cẩn. That is called the Assassin, and it depicts
Saigon
so.
Execution.
Oh, the execution. Sorry,
Saigon execution.
Saigon execution. There was something different on the internet. Okay, so this image, you know, really transformed the Vietnam War. And there's lots of writings on what's the impact of this image. But even from the photographer themselves, and it's written in Mai Zora's piece, Meta Eulogy of Nguyễn Ngọc Cẩn. And she basically, you know, says that, you know, do not fall to war, you know, this was part of a war propaganda machinery that essentially fueled the anti-war movement in the U.S. and increased critique of ARVN. But really, the picture reveals a much more deep meaning behind it, a different kind of truth. And in essence, this panel is about unraveling concepts of truth, memory, and history. So even something like this has a much more complex meaning. And images like this have shaped so much our history, but now they're just new scholarship to have us rethink about these ideas. So with no further ado, give it over to Zora.
All right, thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you all for joining us. So today we have five panelists with us. If we could get the picture of the Google Hangout, I can kind of do some quick introductions and I'll let the panelists introduce themselves. My name is Zora Mai Quynh, I will be your moderator tonight. To my left here is Nguyen An, who translated her father's book. This is her father behind us, Nguyen Cong Luan. This is his memoir right here. And all the works that you'll be seeing today touches upon the need to build a collective memory for South Vietnamese people who are living in the diaspora. And they all capture it, an attempt to excavate the truth, as Mrs. Espiritu has said in her paper. So you'll hear from Nguyen Cong, who translated her father's work, and sitting to her left is Jay Veith, whose book Black April is right here. And Jay has spent 10 years, an enormous amount of time, engaging in extensive interviews with many participants to obtain firsthand knowledge of their career and their battles in which they participated. And his book is an excellent book that goes through many battles in depth. To his left is Nathalie Nguyen, whose book on South Vietnamese soldiers is based on oral histories of South Vietnamese women and men who served. And these are the memoirs of people who are not necessarily higher ranked military officials, but those who served in the ranks and among the masses, people that you don't generally hear often. Her book has been noted as an important and overdue treatment of the missing pieces of the Vietnam War. And finally, you'll hear from Evyn Le Espiritu, on Google Hangout. She's over here in the corner. Her work engages oral histories of people, in particular her own relatives in Vietnam, to excavate the truth around Colonel Hồ Ngọc Cẩn. Thank you, Ben. Sorry, Evyn. So why don't we start and let our panelists introduce themselves. So 2 minutes each panel, just introduce yourself. Tell us what motivated you to do the work that you're currently doing.
My name is Tường Anh, Nguyễn Hà Tường Anh. My father, Mr. Nguyễn Cong Luan, was a major in the ARVN. He wrote the book. He did not consider this as a biography. He's not that famous to sell the biography. He called that a memoir of a victim turned soldier. He was a victim of the communism, and he was drafted into the army. I wouldn't say against his will, but if that was a peaceful time, he would be a lawyer. That's what he said. His book would be a gift from him, his generation, to the younger generations. Hopefully, you will understand what the ARVN, the Vietnamese soldiers and officers, had gone through. Take that as an experience in order to plan for your future plans. And democracy still is the number one goal of the ARVN until now. Thanks.
Hi, my name is Jay Veith. This is my third book on the Vietnam War. The first two were on the American rescue efforts of prisoners of war during the conflict. This one is totally different. It deals with the military history of the last 2 years of the war. In other words, after the Americans left, the fighting still continued despite the Paris Peace Accords. And unfortunately, a lot of Americans had a very negative view of the South Vietnamese military. And so my attempt here was to show that that was completely wrong, that the South Vietnamese did stand and fight pretty much the entire time to the very end.
Hello, everyone. My name is Nathalie Nguyen. I did a doctorate at the University of Oxford in literature. But I've always been interested in memory from my own experience as a child refugee. My father was the last Republic of Vietnam ambassador to Japan in 1974-75, and a lot of my interest in refugees and the Vietnamese diaspora comes from that family experience, that personal experience. This is my fourth book. I've spent 10 years working on Vietnamese refugees and the Vietnamese diaspora, but my second and third books focused on Vietnamese women. So this is the first book that focuses on veterans, both male and female. And it includes some senior officers. There are two lieutenant colonels, but a lot of the service personnel that feature in this were junior officers during the war, so they were young officers in their 20s, they were lieutenants, or they were in the ranks, the squad leaders, and there are some NCOs as well, sergeants. So a very wide range of voices, in fact, covering all the services, Army, Navy, Air Force, as well as the Marines, the Airborne, the Rangers, and the Women's Armed Forces Corps, and the regional forces as well. So a very wide range of voices that are covered in the book. And my purpose, as Q Lin has mentioned, was really to capture these voices before they disappeared. Because I mean, my father's generation, I lost my father in 2013, it's a generation that is disappearing. So it's so important to capture these voices and these experiences before they go. Thank you.
Now I think we can hear from Evyn Le Espiritu. 2 minutes.
Okay. Hi, thank you everybody for being here. My name is Evyn Le Espiritu, and I'm a filmmaker and PhD candidate in the Department of Rhetoric at UC Berkeley. And my current project looks at the Vietnamese refugee diaspora in Guam and Palestine, Israel. But tonight I'll be presenting my short documentary, Who with Colonel Hồ Ngọc Cẩn,
which is about my granduncle, my grandmother's brother. And I shot it in 2012 and then completed it in 2013. So I want to talk a little bit briefly about my motivations for making this film. So this project actually came out of a different film project. I was doing an oral history of my grandmother, who left Vietnam in April 1975. And in one of the interviews, she was talking about her older brother who had served in ARVN. And she made this sort of casual reference, like, oh, by the way, he's famous, and you can find videos of him online. And I didn't make much of this sort of reference at that point. And it wasn't until later, when I was going through back through the sort of post-production footage, that it sort of stuck out to me. So I typed my grand uncle's name into Google, and I was so surprised, because I was actually was taken aback by this deluge of information, YouTube videos venerating him as a hero, given that he was one of the few ARVN soldiers who refused to surrender and was subsequently publicly executed. And it was a moment where I was really struck by the simultaneous absence and excess surrounding ARVN soldiers, like my granduncle, Colonel Hồ Ngọc Cẩn. So absence here on multiple registers. I was really struck by this question, where if he was so famous, how come I never heard about him for the first 21 years of my life? So the film that you'll see later on this evening takes this sort of organized forgetting around ARVN soldiers as a point of departure. So they didn't fit into the communist Vietnamese state's narrative of nationalist liberation and reunification, and they were elided by the American narrative of the Vietnam War. And then sort of within my own family was a very painful history that we didn't talk about. So I'm really excited to be part of this important panel and to sort of combat these structured silences. And I realized in the process of making this film that even with all this sort of silence, there is a sort of bursting excess of information. So people who are really willing to talk and share their memories, if I just took the time to listen. So I hope you enjoy the film.
Thank you. We'll be seeing the film later towards the end of the panel. So we have some presentations by our panel, so I'd like to invite Nathalie up to do her presentation. I don't know if you're doing it here or not. Stand there. Oh, are we having? Okay, you're first.
Yes.
Account of the war, which is something in particular. So it's the narrative of Nguyen, who, I'm going to show you his picture. He did a law degree at the University of Saigon, and then he was mobilized to the armed forces. He went to Duke Academy in 1972, and then opted to join the Rangers, an elite unit in the South Vietnamese Armed Forces. So that's him as a warrior. And that's images of Rangers.
Okay.
Now this is the story. He was wounded in combat, and then he was wounded so badly that he couldn't actually continue to serve on the front line. So he opted to go back to civilian life and to go to the Saigon Supreme Court until the end of the war. But after the war, he became a refugee. He was in hiding from the Vietnamese authorities because he wanted to avoid imprisonment in the re-education camps. And eventually he escaped from Vietnam as a boat person and found refuge in Australia. And many years after settlement, he sought news of three missing friends from the Rangers. And one of these friends was Major Chung Dinh Phu. So that's the story that I will be telling tonight. So this is Ahn speaking about his friend. Quen Tu heard the news that President Dung Van Minh had ordered the army to surrender to the North Vietnamese. He told his battalion, Major Chan Dinh Tu was the commander of the 38th Ranger Battalion. The 38th Ranger Battalion was formed part of the 32nd Ranger Group retreating from Tay Ninh to Saigon right at the end of the war, so the end of April 1975. Okay, so this is Ahn talking about what happened. Quen Tu heard the news that President Dung Van Minh had ordered the army to surrender to the North Vietnamese. He told his battalion, "I will fight until the end because Rangers never surrender. Those who want to join me, take this side, and those who want to return to base, take that side. About 100 soldiers joined his group. He told the vice commander, take this group back to the base. Give us all your weapons and ammunition. So they fought from 10 o'clock in the morning until the next day, the 1st of May, when they ran out of ammunition. They still had their weapons, but no more ammunition. By that time, there were only 10 survivors. No, 13 with him, 13 survived. When he was captured by the North Vietnamese, their leader told him, I order you to remove your South Vietnamese rank insignia. He refused. He said, the South Vietnamese army placed my rank insignia here. They never told me how to remove it. I am now your prisoner, a prisoner of war, and I am allowed to keep my rank insignia. The North Vietnamese leader got very angry and said, in that case, I order you to take off your shirt. Again, Du refused. He said, no, I'm a prisoner of war and I'm allowed to keep my uniform. The North Vietnamese commander stabbed him and then shot him in the head. He then ordered that all of Du's remaining men be killed. They were shot and left in one big hole. One of the soldiers who had returned to the base told Du's wife that he'd heard that Du was killed somewhere nearby. So on the 1st of May in the afternoon, Du's wife went to the battlefield to look for his body. She could not find it. The next day she returned and still could not find it, until a local guerrilla told her, give me some money and I will tell you where I buried them, all the men of the ranger group. He then took her to the site and Du's wife took his body back to Saigon and buried him. I was very sad when I heard this, but I said to myself that he died a brave death and that he died like a soldier. So I spread the news about Du. Many people admire him, and at ceremonies to remember the sad day of 30th April 1975, people still put up his photo in memory of the past and to remind people that rangers never surrender. That's Du, my friend. Okay, so this is Anne talking about his friend. So the discussion now about this event. This is a telling incident and far from atypical of the events that took place in the final days of South Vietnam. In his book, Black April, George Veith makes the following reference to Trần Đình Tu and the events of April 30th, 1975, and I quote, the 32nd Ranger Group attempting to retreat from Tay Ninh on 29th April was blocked on Route 1 by the 316th Division. One battalion, the 38th Rangers, refused to surrender and fought until the end. According to Ranger sources, the battalion commander, Major Trần Đình Tu, was promptly executed. In a well-publicized example, Colonel Hồ Ngọc Cẩn, the province chief of Chuong Tien and soldier of the year 1972, also refused to surrender. He fought until he ran out of ammunition. He was also executed shortly thereafter, unquote. Nguyen Hu An's narrative is predicated on a series of layers. The first is the context of the oral history interview. An knew that his interview formed part of a major oral history project on Vietnamese veterans in Australia, and that it would be preserved in a key national institution. It was important for him that Du's story be put on record. As Beth Robertson notes, one of the most important uses of oral history is to record the perspectives of disadvantaged people who traditionally have been either ignored or misrepresented in conventional historical records. Oral history, therefore, not only gives Arndt the opportunity to tell his own life story and to shed light on the service of South Vietnamese Rangers, but also provides him with a vehicle for reconstructing Du's narrative and the story of the men of the 38th. The second is the fact that the news of Du's fate had such a powerful effect on Han that he wrote a lengthy article on Du that was published in three installments in the Sydney-based Vietnamese newspaper, Viet Nam, in 2009, entitled Nho Va Doi, the article, he and I. The article is essentially the account of a friendship. The two boys, Han and Du, had similar backgrounds. Both were from North Vietnamese families and were refugees in 1954. While An's father was a teacher, Du's father was a civil servant. An relates the series of temporary shelters where northern refugees were housed and the allocations of rice and water each family received from the South Vietnamese government. When these shelters closed, each family received a small amount of money to assist with their resettlement.
and two ended up in the same primary school and were placed in the same class. Both initially experienced prejudice from Southern children because they were from the North and had Northern accents. Du was 3 years older than An and defended him against bullies. Both boys gradually won over their schoolmates. Their friendship endured even though they attended different high schools. Du volunteered for army service after finishing high school and was class 14 at Thu Duc Academy. He joined the Rangers the following year. In 1964, he confided to An, "We've already left the North. If we cannot defend the South, where are we going to live?" The last time An saw his friend was 4 years later in 1968, when Du was a young captain in the 33rd Ranger Battalion and had just returned from an operation. Despite the fact that An joined the Rangers in 1972, they lost sight of each other for the rest of the war. An's portrayal of his family's history after migration to the South is of particular interest because it deals with an aspect of Nguyen Cong Luan's presidency that is seldom acknowledged. In 1954-55, South Vietnam was a small country with a population of approximately 10, maybe 11 million, struggling to establish itself in the aftermath of war and decolonization. And yet, it was able to absorb a massive influx of 1 million refugees from North Vietnam. A third layer is that An's reconstruction of events is drawn from two other written accounts. One is an article published in the Ranger magazine in 2000, which relates that the story of Major Chan Dinh Tu and the man of the 38th was derived from two eyewitness accounts, that of Captain Sul, second in command of the 38th, and that of a Ranger trooper named Duc Joc, who was responsible for carrying communication gear for Tu and was left for dead when the survivors of the battalion was shot by the North Vietnamese. Duc Joc managed to crawl to a nearby house where the people dressed his wounds and told him he could return to Saigon. A third eyewitness was, of course, Du's wife, who was able to reclaim her husband's body at the site of the executions, but her story did not come to light until after 2009. The information in the Ranger magazine article was superseded by a second account, that of Du's son, Chan Dinh Thai, who writes of the excavation of the mass grave of Rangers in 2011. Thai recounts that his mother recovered his father's body on the 3rd of May 1975 from Trung Lap Tha Primary School in Bu Chi. Du and two other officers were shot at the school and buried on site. The mass grave of 12 soldiers who were also shot lay in a nearby field, now part of a farm. The farmer did not witness the executions, but was told by the people who lived in the area about the Rangers retreating from Tien Ninh and the hole in his field that contained the bodies of 12 soldiers. He advised Thai that he did not dare plant any rice at the site and that he made offerings to the dead soldiers every new year. A former local guerrilla described to Thai the final moments of the 38th, its surviving men exhausted and out of ammunition. Thai chronicles the exhumation of bodies at the site. The first item retrieved was a leg bone in a faded sock with tied nylon rope, which indicated to Thai that the men were bound when they were shot. Next were the dog tag and military identification card from Li Ah Sung, listing his date of birth as 19th May 1950, his father as Li Man Soi and his mother as Ho Ti Min. And the identification card of Jin Ngoc Thuan, listing his date of birth as 3rd March 1957, his father as Jin Hu Hien, and mother as Hua Ti La. Sam was 24 and Thuan 18. The exhumation was witnessed by approximately 40 local people. More human remains, articles of clothing, and other artifacts were retrieved, including a watch with a black leather wristband and a wallet containing the photograph. Including a watch with a black leather wristband and a wallet containing the photograph of a person in uniform with a girl too faint to be identified. And the time on the watch is 4:30 p.m. day 31st. Thai writes that one set of remains was cremated along with articles of clothing, a belt, and coils of nylon rope, and the remainder placed in a large glazed earthenware jar called a cup in the hope that the families of the Rangers would reclaim the remains. Published the correspondence from Thai in 2012, including photographs of the school where Chan Dinh Tu was shot and buried, the field where the bodies of his men were laid, and part of the human remains and artifacts recovered at the site. A third account published in 2013 suggests that Du and his men were shot by communist guerrillas rather than by North Vietnamese soldiers. These accounts reveal the difficulty of recreating battlefield events based on eyewitness testimonies decades after the end of the war. There are discrepancies between the oral and written accounts in terms of the details of events and Du's final moments. All accounts, however, broadly agree on the following sequence of events. Chan Dinh Tu and the men of 38th Battalion continuing to fight, the capture of Du and a group of survivors by enemy forces, an altercation between Du and the enemy leader, the execution of Du and several of his men, and their mass burial at the site. Significantly, the exhumation of human remains and the removal of personal effects and other artifacts at the gravesite attest to a desire by surviving relatives to provide a tangible record of the events of 1975. The actions by Du's son Thai in locating the mass grave, having the site excavated, the soldiers' remains and other identifying items retrieved, and photographing and recording the proceedings constitute an act of witnessing. Thai writes that it was a notice placed in 2011 by the family of Le Van Dai, a ranger of the 38th who went missing on the retreat from Tay Ninh, that led him to contact Thai's family and search for the burial of the man. That correspondence indicates that by acting as he did, he sought to give the family of Le Van Dai some form of closure. The story of Chan Dinh Tu and the man of the 38th illustrates the disjuncture between public and private memories of the war. While there is neither official acknowledgement of these events from the Vietnamese state, nor a formal forensic investigation of the gravesite, the story of Du and of his men endures in the collective memory of local inhabitants. As Selma Ladisdorf, Luisa Pasrini, and Paul Tonflin note, and I quote, memories supportive of the maintenance of existing power structures are usually a shorter, wider social space and easier transmission. But memories of subordinate groups can also show striking resilience, and they can be transmitted from the interstices of society, from the boundaries between the public and the private. The reconstruction of...
Oh,
okay.
Yeah, fine.
Yeah. Okay, I just finished that one paragraph. The reconstruction of Du's story is valuable in that first, it relates a little-known episode of the Vietnam War. Second, it is a narrative that has been remembered, recorded, and retold by survivors as well as colleagues, friends, and relatives of the deceased. And third, it is symbolically a matter of pride and grief for former rangers and soldiers of the ARVN. Thank you.
Thank you. Next, we're going to hear from Jay Wright. And also, Jay, you have 15 minutes.
Findings is that despite a large number of books that were written about the fall of Saigon, almost all of them were written in the 80s, mainly by journalists and by a few people who were there, none of them had access to one of those primary source documents. So while those sources and those depictions of the fall of Saigon sort of give the broad story, they do not get into the details. They do not really sort of understand what really happened. And most of those books are on the American perspective, not the South Vietnamese perspective. So, in reality, this major historical event has not really undergone any deep analysis. And so I undertook to find out exactly what had happened and to challenge some myths that had grown about the fall of South Vietnam. So in reality, the rapid collapse of South Vietnam in 55 days had really sort of cemented this image of South Vietnam as this weak vassal state that was a simple push for the communists, this whole house of cards to collapse. And so you also had these images of this uncontrolled chaos and all this rioting and looting in Da Nang, people trying to get on the ships to escape. And so these images, along with the scenes from the people trying to retreat from the Central Highlands, just really sort of cemented this whole image of South Vietnam as this really weak, corrupt, ungovernable state. But a closer examination of the facts, a really deep dive into what really happened on the ground in the last couple of years, reveals a much different story. And so what these sources indicate, both primary and secondary and oral history indicate, is that there was a far more complex series of events than the simple collapse of this weak and corrupt state. So the simple question for you to ask then is, how do I know all this? So we undertook probably one of the largest, if not one of the largest, Vietnamese translation projects ever undertaken. And we went through, not only has the US government declassified virtually everything that they have from the very top level down to some pretty simple stuff, but we went through a very large amount of communist and South Vietnamese sources. Most people nowadays, unless you are sort of deep into the Vietnamese historiography, don't realize that the communists have published an enormous amount of material on the war. They published hundreds of unit histories, memoirs, biographies, newspaper articles. They're justifiably proud of their liberation of South Vietnam. So we went through, and we went through almost 100 different communist military books, 19 different memoirs, almost 100 different articles in both Vietnamese and English. But it was also important not to get just the US side and the North Vietnamese side. It was absolutely critical to get the South Vietnamese viewpoint on this, because once again, I did not want to write something about the South Vietnamese and not have the South Vietnamese voice heard in that. Many senior Vietnamese leaders, some who had never spoken on the record before, who did not want to speak on the record, and I interviewed over 45 of these guys, from General Cao Van Vien, who was the very head of the South Vietnamese military, all the way down to guys who commanded battalions. So I interviewed over 45 officers. We looked at over 30 books written by guys, over 80 articles, and I also, I think one of the things I hope to be able to do in the future is that I had people write for me their stories, not just me interviewing them and taking notes, but they actually wrote down, here's what had happened to me during this battle. And I, one day, I'll give those notes to somebody and be able to publish, and people like you will be able to access these documents. So this was a critical aspect of my study, was being able to get all three sides of the story. All right, so what are some of these myths that I alluded to in the fall of South Vietnam? There's four key ones that I'll talk about very quickly since I have 15 minutes now. So the North Vietnamese did not make the decision to strike until late 1974. That's not true. The South Vietnamese military collapsed because they were weak and ineffective. Also not true. U.S. aid cuts did not hurt the South Vietnamese, which is untrue. While the Soviets and Chinese poured in aid, this is actually something that's pretty controversial. Not correct, and that the ARVN put a very little fight, and that the communists rolled in the Saigon. All right, so let's take a look at that first myth. Most people looking at the fall of South Vietnam think that Nixon's resignation in August of 74 sparked the North Vietnamese to make the decision to attack. That's actually not true. The actual decision to resume warfare was made almost immediately upon signing the Paris Peace Accord. Their initial strategy was to emphasize what they called political struggle, which meant they were going to try to compete with South Vietnam economically and politically, and they thought, once the Americans had withdrawn, that South Vietnam, with its internal contradictions, would just collapse internally and they could walk in and take over. And so they thought to themselves, the situation is going to develop along two lines. Either we're going to have peace or we're going to have war. One of the two are going to happen. And while they have a tendency to think in very simplistic terms, they were also very right. So, but believing their own propaganda, they're expecting South Vietnam to collapse. And when it doesn't, and actually grows stronger with the Americans' withdrawal, now they've got a problem. What do we do now, okay? So So they met 60 days after the signing the Paris Peace Accords in late March, and Lê Duẩn, who was an ardent fanatic about reuniting the Vietnams, starts immediately pushing the other Politburo members to that the South Vietnamese are massively violating the accords, that they're not, these guys are the ones that are causing the problems, we've got to do something. Now, he says to them, we cannot let an opportunity is taking us 20 years, in other words, getting the Americans out and just doing the South Vietnamese, to slip through our fingers. Now, in a very odd turn of events, he is supported on this by Ngo Minh Nhuận, who had, oddly enough, not supported the Tet Offensive or the 72 Offensive, something that's very little known. But Jacques believes that now that the Americans are completely gone, their air power is gone, their naval gunfire is gone, that his army, despite the tremendous loss that they've taken in 72, are stronger than the South Vietnamese. Which isn't true, but that's the way they believe. They attacked one corps at a time. And that enables the South Vietnamese, to shift forces and able to defeat those attacks. But there was extremely heavy fighting. In fact, the army took 15,000 dead and wounded alone in the summer of 1974. Let's skip this one. So the third myth we talked about, that U.S. aid cuts beginning in the late December of 1973 had no impact on the South Vietnamese. That was completely false. But by the summer of 74, they were forced to reduce their ammunition expenditure to only two rounds of 105, which is the main artillery, a gun today, you can reduce it very quickly. And they were out of gas by July for their aircraft and their tanks. It's hard to fight a war without supplies. Economic aid cutbacks are just as bad. And then I found this to be a fascinating thing, is that soldiers in the 3rd Division, this is probably actually pretty common, hadn't eaten any meat the entire month. Kind of tough to fight a war when you're only eating rice every day. we'll kind of skip through some of this. All right, so the 4th myth, the Battle of Saigon. And I found this to be some actually fascinating things. So in typical fashion, when you read communist publications, trust me, they are not very, shall we say, complimentary of the South Vietnamese fighting skills. However, in certain instances, they had to finally admit that they had, in fact, the Battle of Saigon was far tougher than ever imagined. And in fact, we had a couple of different quotes that came out. So at the army school, which was to the west of Saigon, was one of the very first, attacks on the last day. Not only did the South Vietnamese sort of hodgepodge task force hold their ground, they actually counterattacked and drove the Northern Vietnamese out of the army school. And the fighting was so heavy, they killed over 400 Vietnamese. And so, one of the, because most of the fighting took outside of Saigon, people say they killed over 400. The deputy commander of the 2nd Corps found that so outrageous that he said, anyone says that we attacked and captured Saigon without breaking a single light bulb, and we'll give him a shovel and dig the graves of our dead. During our attack on Saigon, our 2nd Corps, which is the guy who attacked the army school, lost more than 400 men. So I wonder how people can write such things. Trust me when I tell you that that is a very rare comment by North Vietnamese like the South Vietnamese. I should tell you something. So I just wanted to leave you with the last couple of thoughts, and that is, history written by Americans is generally for Americans, right? And so you as a younger generation should sit down and start thinking about how you can shape your own history. Because it shouldn't be guys like me writing your history. It should be guys like you writing your history. Thank you very much.
What is your
I tell you my qualification. First of all, I'm the daughter. That's him and that's me. The two boys are very quiet in the house. I translated his book from English into Vietnamese, and hopefully we can get it published soon. He claims to be a Vietnamese nationalist, and I am here on behalf of my father, who is a Vietnamese nationalist, and I myself is a Vietnamese nationalist. So when we invite you to have a revisit of the ARVN, I think this effort is late, but a must be. So thank you for being here. Now, the format that my father had prepared for me is very similar to the presentation that you just heard. This picture was everywhere, and now you still get to see it. A colonel executing a VC, a Viet Cong communist. This is the second famous one, a burned girl running from the central of Vietnam being burned by the bomb. And she's currently in the U.S. However, you didn't hear why he was executed. He killed 35 people, including officers, police officers, the soldiers, the wives, and the children. Now, what would you do if someone came to assassinate your neighbors, your friends, your relatives, 35 of them in a few days? What would you do except this? You didn't know what he did. His and his troop, this is what they did to us. The Tet Offensive, 1968. During the Tet, you know, we closed our everything. We are ceasefire. They killed that many people in mass killing, put them down in a mass grave. This is how we dig the grave. And the relatives just cried without being able to identify the body. We did that in order to give them the proper burial. Each of them deserved, you know, a burial without knowing who they were. And that we could do because the ARVN regained the power in the central of Vietnam. This is the victory of Quảng Trị Citadel. If you had a chance to visit my country, go to Quảng Trị, you still see the bullets on the citadel. They continue to protect the civilians. This is how they transferred the wounded civilian in the Tet Offensive 1968 in Saigon. They work with the American advisors. They continue to fight, they continue to sacrifice. And what do they get now? Until now is a misunderstanding. So what I would like to do is to remind you, we have heroes from the war who are now still alive. But these seven people, the one on the left and the one on the right, this is Lieutenant Colonel Nguyễn Văn Long and Colonel Hồ Ngọc Cẩn, and the five generals, Trần Văn Hai, Lê Nguyên Vĩ, Nguyễn Khoa Nam, Lê Văn Hưng, Phạm Văn Phú, they took their lives instead of surrendering on the April 30th of 1970. This is a picture I got from the internet, so I didn't have the control on it. So again, somehow we use also myths, just like this. The first myth is the Army of the Republic of Vietnam, ARVN, was the dominant force, but they still lost the war, so shame on them. Now let's see the birth and the life of the ARVN. First of all, in the late 1930s, under King Bảo Đại was created by the French. Then the National Army of Vietnam was born. They had limited power. They have no division or army corps. That's how weak they are. Their weapons, equipment, logistics, training were French style. They have low moral and discipline. Then we declare in October 1955 the Republic of Vietnam, which is from the south, the central and the south of Vietnam. The Army of Republic of Vietnam, the ARVN, was founded from the NAVN. So you can see, with the same thing, limited power, role model and discipline. And then ARVN would be a young army in a young country who was asked to fight back the enemy of the North. So my father said, the ARVN encountered difficulties and troubles all its life. The modern war policy strategies were employed, but they were incapable of winning the war insurgency. I'm sorry for these typos, I think I repeat those. Now, in 1951, the Vietnamese Communist Party declared a policy of consideration to South Vietnam. The real war began. They attacked the 21st Division Base Camp. They have the uprising in Binh Trieu, which is the south of Vietnam, and they founded the National Liberation Front. That is the ARVN, a young tree growing up from the tough ground and suffer the very severe weather. It needs to grow up strong to fight back. Who was they facing? They are facing the National Liberation Front Army, or the VC. Now, if you visit Vietnam, now don't say VC or Viet Cup, or you'll be in trouble. But we call them the VC. And you have to know that they have seasoned fighters. Don't forget, they won the war against the French. They chased out the French in 1954. They used the fear machine to control people. Now you guys were born in a peaceful time, you know, parents give you everything you need, you are here. But when you have to have a system of food every month, you will be scared. You're gonna have to go to the office of the little village presenting how many people you have in a house, get certain amount of rice, forget about meat, just rice or, I think, flour. And if your son or your daughter or your husband was drafted into the army of ARVN, that's it. The person would not be allowed to receive anything, and then the food ration will be dropped for the whole family. So when you are hungry, it's very easy for people to keep a control on you. And then the control was very tight from the village level. They have the police officers for a couple blocks of the streets. They know who you are, they know where you go, they know who you talk to or meet. And they use unconventional war. What is unconventional war? Conventional war is when, okay, here we go, we're gonna fight at that time. You use the cannons, you know, I have grenades, whatever, but guess what? They just attack you whenever they want, out of the ambush, okay? So that's tough to stay away from, to defend yourself and then your civilian. They have very heavy support from the China and the USSR, the Russia. Now, the ARVN, if we talk about, well, the North has support, the ARVN, they had support too. What support did they have? From 1961 to 1973, we had the American participation. What did we have? We have more powerful conventional warfare tactics and sophisticated weapons and techniques. Now, sophisticated weapons, could you use that when you run through the jungles and a little child holding a grenade, you know, asking for candies and then leave the grenade right in the middle of you and your soldiers. The ARVN was independent in war policy, so people used to think that the Americans come and tell us what to do. No, we were independent in making the policies.
5 more minutes.
The psychological warfare was not powerful enough. We have the psych warfare. But guess what? It turned out to be just a cultural show when, you know, like Bob coming to entertain the soldiers. We just had to say we didn't really fight back. Now about the American advisors, they had teams in the ARVN. They supported support us by giving advice and help us in the inspection of aids and equipment, but not in command or management.
I'm sorry, can I please ask the audience to hold their comments until the very end? We're going to give you a chance to do question and answer at the very end, so if you have questions, please write it down, and we'll let you ask, but right now, can we please allow the presenters to present without a word?
So according to my father, he saw the best group of advisors from 1955 to 1964. He said they were well-trained and they won the sympathy from the common peoples. We have the South Korea and Australia helps too. They said South Korea sent two infantry divisions and one marine brigade. They brave, they best at ambushes, they rub hands to the enemy, and Australia sent 11 battalions. They did won several battles, including the Second Lumpen Battle in 1966. Now, you have to know that the VC was very good at the psychological warfare and terrorism. That was the principal weapon. That is why in the US back then, you saw all of the pictures that were dirty, the reputation of the ARVN instead of the real truth. For example, the Saigon execution. They used children to attack with grenades. This is horrible. They use also women, but also children. They can burn your house or whole village if they find one family or one person supporting the ARVN. Everyone was scared. So, but the ARVN at that time has their own difficulties. They had discipline but was not strict. And the soldiers were very poor. They lived in the barracks, and then they have a barracks for wives and children. That's what the wife and the children, especially the suburbans, would prepare ammunition and fought along with the husbands or the fathers. Battles after battles worn them out. They didn't have a chance to refresh at all. So that's them, fighting, putting their own lives down, and continue to fight, you know, being very tired. I would invite you to demyth the first myth. I would say that the ARVN was strong, but in mind and in will. And we lost the war because we have inefficient strategies and tactics. We fought against a fierce and atrocious enemy. We were not able to use inhuman policies in order to fight back the unconventional war attacks. The second myth would be the Vietnam War is just a typical civil war. My father disagreed with that. He said that civil war, you know, occurred in many countries, but the VC terrorized its citizens, and they used the food rationing system in the north. That was the best tool to control the people. And you can see that during the Vietnam War, you wouldn't see any Chinese or Russian soldiers, but you see American soldiers, and that was bad on us, because that brought back the memory of colonialism from the French that we chased away in 1954. People didn't want to bring it back. And they brainwashed their soldiers. In the South, we have families that have relatives drafted into the VC, and they turned around and ambushed us.
1 minute.
And they lied. You know, their best tool is lying. So I would like to ask you to demyth the second myth. Vietnam War is not a typical civil war. The third myth, I would run fast. People said that the ARVN are a bunch of losers, you know. I myself disagree with that. The foregone victories include the two-hole policy. We called back, this is the open arm policy, we called back the VC soldiers, 200,000 of them coming back to us. For the Phoenix campaign, we neutralized 60,000 of them and killed 26,000 of them. The security was established in the populous areas with no more snipers or ambushes. After the 1968 Tet Offensive, the political attitude of the Vietnamese people, especially the people in the South and the Central, was changed in favor of the ARVN. So I would like to have you looking at my father, who is old and weak at home right now. Back then, this is a Vietnamese nationalist along with friends of his lifetime, continue fighting right now, can walk around the street being old people mumbling about the war. Please listen to them, because that's the history that creates you today. So on behalf of my family, thank you very much. Thank you.
So we're going to be viewing who was Colonel Hồ Ngọc Cẩn. And then we'll hear from the documentary.
Bên Nam thì anh hai phải bảo vệ cái gì anh hai Hoặc là of Vietnamese people live in the United States here, they already know a lot about my brother because every year they do Memory Day for him. And they make, you know, they do it in the TV, Vietnamese TV, and things that view and do that bunch of stuff. Everybody, I feel like most of them already know. But I just want to see them in my family side. It's just all I know.
This is our story, our family's story. A story of a brother, a cousin, a granduncle, a man we loved and continue to love, a man we remember, a public hero and traitor. We do not share his glory, we do not share his fame. Who has a claim to the writing of history? We voice our memories, he is archived on our hearts.
He's my grand uncle. So my grandmother is one of about like 10 siblings, and Colonel Gunn is the oldest. My grandmother is the third, so she's the second oldest sister. And my grandmother was a huge help here. So I sort of wrote the questions and did the videography, but she was the one that really conducted the interviews with her siblings in Vietnamese. And this was a really learning process for her too. As I mentioned, she came to the U.S. in 1975, and so really didn't learn that her brother was executed until years after the fact, and so this was a really sort of traumatic memory for her, and something that she, you know, there are a lot of stories around her brother that she had not heard before. So this was a huge process for both of us. And then I conducted some more research just looking at South Vietnamese Americans, online commemorations of Colonel Gunn, especially sort of Army veterans writing from the U.S. And I interviewed specifically Lieutenant Hoang Pham, who uploaded the majority of the YouTube videos venerating Colonel Gunn that you sort of see in the opening montage. And he put me in contact with Craig Mandeville, who you also see featured. He's an American Vietnam War veteran who served with Colonel Gunn in Vietnam from 1972 to 1973 in Vietnam. And so I met and filmed him in Westminster, California. So in spring 2013, I started post-production for this film, and I really struggled with how to present the multiple competing narratives. As I mentioned before, there was this sort of paradoxical feeling of both absence and excess. Which is the sort of word pairing that you see in the beginning. So on one hand, there was a sort of structured, organized forgetting or silence around this history. But on the other hand, there was sort of this wealth of information once I started looking for it. And I really wanted to present the simultaneity of these multiple overlapping narratives to present through the form, as well as the content, the complex layers of history and memory surrounding my granduncle and ARVN soldiers more broadly. So you have multiple narratives sort of going on here, right? So it's a barrage of information, which sort of reproduces sort of barrage of information that I felt when I started doing this research. So on the soundtrack, you have the voices of Colonel Gunn's siblings in Vietnamese, which I purposely left untranslated. And then you have a sort of running timeline in white text that highlights the events and achievements in Colonel Gunn's life as identified by those who memorialized him online. In the scrolling handwritten text on yellow paper, you have what identify as four different narratives that surround Colonel Gunn. So one propagated by the Vietnamese state, the communist state, one sort of by U.S. historiography on the Vietnam War, others by sort of ARVN soldiers, then there's a sort of later personal, so Colonel Gunn's siblings, and then me myself as a sort of another generation. Right?
We have about a minute and a half left.
And in the visuals, you really get a diasporic movement. So one of the first montages is sort of the shots of the festival in San Diego, and then the second montage is my sort of movement to Vietnam. I went back with my grandmother in 2012, and we traveled around to view her siblings. And I just want to leave you with a sort of word pairing that you saw near the beginning of the film, and so that's history, her story. So his story, her story as well. So I was really interested in this project too, in a sort of feminist articulation of heroism that came out actually in a lot of the interviews that I conducted with Colonel Gunn's siblings, or my grandmother's siblings. And by this, I mean that they venerated and memorialized him not only for his military valor and bravery in battle, but also for his duty and responsibility as the oldest sibling in this family. So they have a lot of stories about how he looked after the rest of the family, he's very fiscally responsible, he wrote graves to honor his ancestors. And these are some of the more private memories, I think, that don't really come out in these more public online venerations of him. They're really looking at what he did on the battlefield, which is very important as well. So in our narratives about Arvin, I'm interested and the different gender dimension of how we memorialize this past and our loved ones and our family members.
Thank
so
you.
I'll go ahead and stop there.
Thank you. Can you hear me okay, by the way? From where you are, can you hear me? Maybe not. Okay, so we have about 10 minutes of questions, and we have Jay Viet in the back for about 20 more minutes, so why not give him the chance to answer first? The first question we have, and then we're going to open it up to you all to ask. But the first question we have is all the works. Can you hear me, by the way, Mr. Nguyen? And Evyn? Are you guys able to hear me? Put a thumbs up or something?
Yes. Okay, yes, sorry, I wasn't sure
the words. So the question is I will let Jay answer first. All the works seem to revolve around the theme of control over the past or trying to regain control over cultural production and ensuring collective memories for exiled South Vietnamese people. How do you think your work does this, and what have you done to make sure that the stories and the oral histories that you've collected are archived beyond your book?
As a military historian, I don't quite think of those terms, but so if I understand the question correctly, basically what I, let me ask the second part first. So I kept all my notes and transcribed them and keep them on my computer in a Word document labeled. And so one day eventually, not only all the translations that we've done in terms of the South Vietnamese, but the interviews I did will be put up on some, will be put in some archive for people to use in the future. If I can answer the first part of the question, is if I get it right, is that I never tried to look at either South Vietnamese or North Vietnamese or American sources as definitive. I always tried to corroborate them at least twice, because oftentimes when you're dealing with people who are trying to recall things from 30, 35 years ago, there is emotion, there's health, there's a lot of different things that could fog memory. So, you know, Colonel X may say this happened and that happened, and there may be 14 documents that say something different. So who do you believe? And so that corroboration of those both primary sources and the secondary sources was a key aspect in why it took me so long. Okay.
And
why don't I
let Mr. Nguyen answer? We haven't heard from him yet, and he's been waiting for a while. Mr. Bone, did you hear the question? Would you like me to ask again? Did you hear the question, Mr. Bone?
I'm listening.
Okay, you're listening. Let me ask you the question again. So we've talked a lot today about trying to preserve memory for South Vietnamese people who live in exile. How do you think your work does this? I mean, obviously, it's a memoir, but... and. Yeah, let me just ask you that. How do you think you've done this, and what contribution do you wish to see for your book moving forward? Where do you want it to go?
I am ready to contribute anything I have to the effort. But I think we take it with one of the organizations that can do the work. But the won Vietnam in the fighting of the army of the Republic of Vietnam. Is a very great history for the warriors. So it must be preserved, it must be explained to the next generation to understand and to remember the contribution of the army of Vietnam in the country of South Vietnam, the Nationalist, contribute to the peace and the democracy of the world people, of the humankind. So because the war in Vietnam has been reported mostly by wrong reports and by lies and by communist propaganda techniques. So
for future generations. So it's the National Library of Australia, so the standards for very high standards in terms of the recording of the interview, and also there are full transcripts of the interview. So for future scholars will be able to use these oral histories as part of the recorded history of the Vietnam War. In terms of the actual oral histories themselves, I've got a slightly different approach because oral history is really about recording people's lives, and these lives are recorded in their entirety. So I didn't go to the veterans and say, can you please tell me about this specific battle, or can you please tell me about what happened in this year? I asked them to speak about their life story. And usually what emerges when someone speaks about their life story is that the really important elements of that life story will emerge. Whether it emerges in the way you expect it, no, it's something else. But I had some really interesting accounts coming up, like the one that I spoke to you before, about this veteran whose own story is very interesting. And so I do write about it in my book as well, because he had a very interesting experience as a ranger. But when he told me the story about his friend, I found it completely fascinating. And as a historian, I then looked for additional documentation on this account. So the issue with accounts like this is, how do you actually write about a massacre that is unknown, basically? And in this case, the fact that this man was able to look for his friend and found elements of this history, and the fact that the son was motivated to actually go up and look for the grave, for the mass grave of the missing rangers. So it's really the story of an investigation. And the fact that he was actually able to locate the gorilla, the local gorilla, who told his
mother where his father's body was buried. He managed to find this man, and they were able to locate the mass grave and disinter the remains. So there was actual tangible evidence of this massacre. All of this deals with really interesting issues about memory and how you deal with memory and how you try to uncover memory and history decades after the end of the war and after the guns have fallen silent.
Thank you. Let me give Mrs. Espiritu a chance to respond if you want to respond.
Sure, yeah. I guess I want to pick up on this idea of memory and sort of the politics of history and memory and archives. Because it's something I think that I was very aware of, sort of self-reflexive while I was working on this film, right? So what is the relationship between history and memory and its relationship with this idea of truth, right? So how do we deal with this question of conflicting narratives that G brought up? And so my undergrad training was of history, sort of understand this project of trying to find the truth. But I think part of my training now as a PhD student in the Department of Rhetoric is to question the sort of concept of absolute truth, or that there's only one singular truth. So here in this project, I was much more interested in listening to and respecting multiple truths and multiple narratives, right? But also understanding that there were power dynamics that structured these multiple narratives, right? That they weren't all creating or sort of given the ability to be listened to. So, you know, for this film, I relied primarily on interviews with Colonel Gunn's siblings, as I mentioned, as well as information I found online written by ARVN soldiers in the diaspora. So an interesting thing that's come up when I presented this film to different audiences is I've got some questions about the veracity of some of the information I present. So one thing that's come up, for example, is the photographic stills that you see at the beginning of the film. There's some questions about whether all of these featured Colonel Gunn or my grand uncle, or if they featured other soldiers, or some were just dramatic reenactments, right? And then Jay was kind enough to sort of email me in private and sort of bring my attention to some questions around Colonel Gunn's schooling and sort of my reference to the siege of Unbelk. But I really welcome this feedback, and I think it's a really interesting as we sort of move forward in this sort of historical project. But I guess I also want to say, too, that for at least this film, it wasn't my goal necessarily to fact-check or cross-reference what people told me or sort of question how people venerated Colonel Gunn and sort of his biography on the internet. So this, you know, this sort of process is different, I want to say, too, than a sort of state-sponsored archival process or sort of a process of putting these stores into university archive. But I was much more interested in documenting how people remember him, right, or what they choose to remember, what they choose to highlight in all its subjectivity and complexity and sometimes contradiction. And I think this is something that you can really do in the realm of art. And so this is something that I want my film to contribute to the conversation.
Thank you. So we're running really close to our time, so I'm going to allow the audience to ask questions. And I really, really love it for you to think of some questions you can ask Mr. Luan here, who has, he's in Australia, right? Oh, he, no, he's here in San Jose, who's Skyping in today from San Jose, been waiting patiently to hear from you. If you have a chance to read his memoir, it's just excellent. It trails his life all the way from French Indochina, the occupation of Vietnam, Northern Vietnam, all the way to the war and afterwards. So any questions from the audience? We have about 10 minutes. We're gonna try to end on time so that we can get out of here on time. So fire away. Any questions for Mr. Nguyen?
Thank you again. I'm insisting that the idea of making the total comprehensive history the Vietnam War and the Army of the Republic of Vietnam and the participants of the Great War. And the war is very special, especially in its particularity, in its tactics, in its propaganda. But there's no war in the world than the Vietnam War. society and the work morality in the world, the religious ideas and the world power.
About propaganda, which he details in great deal in the first couple of chapters in his book. So, question?
Yes, I have a question for Ms. Nguyen and Mr. Veith. Either during your study, can you have an estimate of how many soldiers of the Republic of Viet Nam still missing now?
Missing in action?
Yeah, missing action. Family or it's a business
paper. There are official JGS statistics, which I don't memorize, but there are official statistics that go through about March 75 in the beginning, but I don't memorize.
And I have this idea about the war in Vietnam. It's very in the meaning that it contributes to the honor of the United States. The only purpose of the United States to prevent democracy and freedom. The United States commits many mistakes, but the main one is the United States as the right cause of the humankind. And it should be preserved. The United States did the right thing by protecting South Vietnam from communism. And it will be one thing to remember that in the research and study about Vietnam War and Vietnam communists must be done very carefully to avoid the dirty tricks of the communist propaganda. It may make the monitory to the big event. It may turn the truth to the false, to the lie. It may make people believe the wrong man. And it may make people accuse the wrong person. So we will carefully when doing the research because there are some stories in Vietnam to prove that in the top level of the Communist Party, some big lies have been taken. For instance, in 1945, when I was a young kid, how the kids of my age believed that Hồ Chí Minh had four things to do.
We have another question here. What was the question answer? I believe it was. Mr. Lung, we have another question. Hold on, can you hold on? Please go ahead.
Good evening. My name is Hada. I have a question, just kind of general. What's been the most difficult part in constructing a collective, or rather contested, memory of the Vietnam War?
What has been the most difficult part of pulling together a contested history of Vietnam War?
I know you need it.
Louder.
Louder?
Yes.
Is that loud enough?
Yeah,
it was very difficult. On a personal level, it was very difficult emotionally because this is very personal for me. It's I was a child refugee. My father served his country. My uncle served in the army and died during the war. And so there's nothing distant about this for me. And there's this vast historiography of the war, very heavily dominated. The English language historiography is heavily dominated by the American experience. And most of this history is either dismissive of South Vietnam or is very negative about South Vietnam. And it's really hurtful. It really hurts. So I know I was only a child during the war, but I'm still affected by this because this was, South Vietnam was my parents' country. So this whole experience of doing the research for this, pulling together these oral histories, and it's not easy to get veterans to agree to speak because the issue of trust comes up. Because
stories. They also gave personal documents. They gave me photographs. Many of them write about their experience in Vietnamese language magazines. Many of the services have associations. And even in Australia, which has a relatively small population base, all the different service associations, like the Ranger Association, the Marines, the Navy, the Air Force, they all publish magazines and with veterans contributing articles. So there's actually a vast amount of material, as in written material, published material in Vietnamese. And I know that Jay has been really active in terms of collecting this information, because there's a much larger population base here in the US and large amounts of material. So it is there if you want to look for it. But historians in the past haven't, because it deals with the South Vietnamese experience.
I'd like to pose this question in Vietnamese first for Bác Luật. Bởi vì là một người Việt Nam thì lúc nào cháu cũng đã đọc cái quyển sách của Bác rồi. Thì cái uất ức là cái chính thể của miền Nam cuối cùng phải thua. Bây giờ cháu muốn lập lại cái câu hỏi ngày hôm qua ở Berkeley là Bác có nghĩ rằng nếu mà Mỹ chỉ giúp cho Việt Nam cũng như là họ sẽ giúp cho Nam Hàn để tự mình đánh với lại Việt Cộng hơn là họ đổ bộ vào và họ đánh để cuối rốt cuộc họ phải rút ra một cách tồi bạc như thế. Bác nghĩ như thế thì từ bây giờ Bắc hay Nam cũng là một dân tộc, nhưng mà bây giờ cái đất nước nó đi như thế thì bác có nghĩ là nếu mà Việt Nam mình đã tự lập tự cường, không có để cho Mỹ vào mà chỉ giúp cho Việt Nam đủ cái sức mạnh để mà chống trả lại Trung Quốc với lại I ask him the same question that Professor Zinnemann asked yesterday. Had the United States allowed Vietnam, just like South Korea, provide us with the military means and the infrastructure to fight on our own strength against, instead of trying to overthrow them and you, and then in the end, quicker than they done that, they withdrew and
do you hear, Mr. Nguyen?
Hi, yes, I would like to answer the question in Vietnamese or in English.
English, if you're comfortable.
English is good, okay?
Yes.
My answer is that question has been involved in my life thinking since I was about 20 years old up to now. The same question occurs in my mind every time I talk about Vietnam War. That if the Vietnam War has been fought with something like the South Korea, I think it there might be has some difference to the result. The difference is the Korean War. The North Korean war communists, but they didn't. They were not the enemy. The type of French war in Vietnam. The French came in the 19th century with the expeditionary corps that treat the Vietnamese people in a very savage way. They use the white terror to control Vietnam. They kill people everywhere. They kill 700 babies. They rape 1,000 women without the intervention of the discipline of the superior officers. They are free to kill, to do anything to the other people. So they fear the animosity, the great animosity against the French. So North Korea didn't have the same thing. communist in nationalist Vietnamese has been fighting the war against France in 1946. The patriotic war until 1947 when the communist turned into the terrorist campaign. They killed, they assassinate all the non-communist nationalist party. They get rid of thousands of young men who could be later, years later, become good nationalist leader in South Vietnam. They killed so many people that South Vietnam were very difficult to find with the best later leaders. The battalion commander, division commander, and regiment commander, the military class leader. Such type of person of the terrorists have been eliminated by the communists in the first wave of the terrorists in 1947. My father was one of them. My father was a communist. But he was thought that not good for the war, so they tried to kill him and his comrade. So the war here was fought by the North Koreans without any animosity against the United States Army or the South Koreans. But the North Vietnamese was not with them. But the Koreans who fought against the United States without animosity particularly. So the end of the thing is the South Korean officer was tough and was very brave, very, very anti-communist. And they have a unity of ideas. The South Vietnamese was divided by situations and unfortunate situations that for the not even did not have the moral morality lies in the North. So I would say that in Vietnam, either way, the outcome is to the North, we will know why in 10 years. But it's impossible to deny that here, because the South Korean officers were much better than the South Vietnamese. South Vietnamese officers were really good. It was French, but the old Vietnamese will fall in the head.
All right, thank you so much, Mr. Luan. We are going to end our program now. That was an excellent answer. Thank you so much, and a good question as well. I think your ride is here, Jay. You want to run out?
We have, they're coming from the East Coast, coming from Australia, coming from as far as San Jose. And we really want to thank the panel, and certainly this has been really historical and monumental, and it shows us how important it is to document the history, that it is contested, that there is no one truth, that but we are fighting against a really strong narrative in the United States against ARVN, and that it is important then to, as young scholars, to investigate this time in history, and we have some of the people who are living testaments to history. So there's still some time to be able to talk to these individuals and investigate issues in the family or these communities. And so, the field now is just really wide open for this. So we thank you for this opportunity, and we'll see you at the next event.